Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid, thank you very much for talking to us.
It's really my pleasure. Try to watch you almost every night when I'm home in time.
That's great to hear. President Obama is out on the road today trying to refocus Americans' attention on the economy, talking about job creation. Do you think he's going to be able to do that? And second of all, do you think the Congress is going to be able to do what it should do this year to improve the economy?
First of all, the president's speech is not a photo op. This is something he's been planning for a long time. I was in the White House recently, and the two of us, and I was stunned about his optimism for doing good things. He's never backed off the what he wants to do is create jobs. He knows that's where the issue is. So this isn't one speech. He's going to give a series of them and, in effect, keep his eye on the prize. And the prize is to do something to help the middle class. So I support what he's doing. And second question you ask me is, what can we do about it here in Congress? I hope that what's taken place in the last week or so has set a better tone here in Washington. The American people are upset at Congress. If one of those pollsters had called me, I would agree with the 83% that thinks we can do a better job. They haven't called me, but if they would, I would tell them how I feel about Congress myself. But what we were able to do, diffuse some of this. We were able to get some Republicans to break away from the pack and start working as we used to do, to compromise to get things done. So I hope that with the financial crisis that's facing us because of what's happened with the Tea Party-driven Republican leadership in the Congress, that reasonable Republicans will break away from this because we can't. You know, they're threatening to not pay the debts the country's already incurred.
So, Senator, are you saying, first of all, are you saying you think Congress can do something about the economy to help the economy this year?
Oh, sure. All we have to do is work together. That's why, as we speak, Patty Murray is working with Susan Collins on an important transportation appropriation bill. We haven't done appropriation bills here for a long time. That's a job-creating measure.
Well, let's talk.
And I would say this. 19 Republicans joined with us to make sure we have a good debate on this bill. That's something that hasn't happened a long time around here.
But let's talk about that poll. You just cited 83% of Americans disapprove of the job the Congress is doing, lowest rate it's ever had. Are Americans right in their perception?
Yes, of course they're right. Gridlock. We have the House of Representatives. They're doing nothing. My friend, the Speaker, was on television on one of the Sunday shows, and he said, my job isn't to pass laws, it's to repeal them. Well, by that metric, he's failed every place because he hasn't passed any laws, and he damn sure hasn't repealed any. We have to start talking about things we work on together, and that is what's missing here.
You say that most of the blame lies with the Republicans, but don't, in fairness, the Democrats bear some of the responsibility?
Judy, you should tell me. I'll take whatever blame is there, but we have people who work all the time trying to come up with issues. I talked about Patty Murray. She has really worked hard. We got a budget passed over here. The Republicans won't let us even go to conference on that. We have Barbara Mikulski, who is so energetic on starting the appropriation process again. She has a wonderful relationship with Dick Shelby, who's her ranking member. And I could go through all my Democratic senators. We're trying to work. But we have a situation here. Let's acknowledge it. The vast majority of the Republicans in the House are Tea Party members. 40% of the Republicans here in the Senate, Tea Party. They represent about 5% of the American people, but they veto everything we do here. And that's why last week there was a breakthrough. John McCain and others, I called John, said, John, we need to try to work something out on this. And he stepped forward with others and did that. When it came time to the floor, I talked about John McCain more than I talked about Democrats.
So that did happen just last week, but today there is talk about potentially another filibuster on funding the president's health care reform, on Obamacare. Could the fix that happened last week turn out to be just temporary?
Judy, if you look at what Mike Lee, the young man from Utah, is talking about, read what he says. What he wants to do is shut down the government to get rid of Obamacare, but in the process, he wants to keep all the good things we have in Obamacare. No pre-existing disability problems, no limits on how much insurance companies have to pay. They want to make sure that all the wellness for millions of seniors still exist. You can stay on your parents' insurance policy to your age 26. He's living in a dreamland. So Republicans, even Republicans won't agree what he's trying to do. And he is a representative of the Tea Party, and that shows how senseless and illogical it is.
But do you think it's possible that what happened last week could turn out just to be temporary, that you could just end up right back at war with
each other? I think it's possible, but I don't believe it's going to happen. I believe that Democrats and Republicans recognize that we have to work together. Take, for example, student loans. Student loans. We had student loans went from 3.4% to 6.8% at the beginning of July for students and their parents trying to get a college education. We can't let that happen, even though that's people we don't have 3.4%. Democrats said, then we're not going to do anything. So we've worked together. Dick Durbin led the charge. And working together with Lamar Alexander, a Democrat and Republican, a liberal and a conservative, and now we're going to approve this legislation because it's a compromise. What it does is says for the next 5 years, parents and children, students I should say, are going to pay far less than 6.8%. That's pretty good.
But so you're saying you believe Republicans are ready to work now with Democrats, but you also are very critical of the Tea Party. So which is it?
It's not an either or. The Tea Party makes up 40%, I repeat, of the Republican caucus in the Senate. They control the House of Representatives. But there are people in the Senate who are breaking away from them. That was proven last week. And, you know, there's still 60% of the Republicans who want to do good things. And I'm confident that some of the people who have Tea Party affiliation, I think even they're tired of the gridlock. The American people are sick of gridlock. We're not doing important things. So we should all work together, even the Tea Party.
Well, despite what you say, there was a low moment very recently when your counterpart, the minority leader in the Senate, Mitch McConnell, said you were on the verge of becoming the worst majority leader the Senate had ever seen. What was your reaction?
Well,
when
Mitch was upset because what I was doing, he thought that was the wrong thing to do, and he was frustrated, but he's, of course, changed his tune on that. Sticks and stones will hurt my bones, but names will never hurt me. I am very happy. I have been the majority leader longer than anyone in the history of this country except for Mike Mansfield, and I'm proud of the work I've done, and so is my Democratic caucus.
So what's your relationship right now with Senator McConnell?
I think because of what happened last week, it's going to be better. We've never been enemies and hated each other. It's just been a little difficult to work together, and I think things will get better. That's one of the things his Republican caucus, told him. He's going to have to start working, and I accept that. We're going to have to start meeting on a regular basis. We haven't been doing that. Bill Frist, who was his Republican predecessor, led the Senate for a number of years for the Republicans. He and I disagreed on a number of things. We met together virtually every week, and we'll have to get back doing that with Senator McConnell.
One of the things the Senate was able to get done was comprehensive immigration reform. Passed the Senate, Republicans came over, worked with Democrats. What do you think is going to happen in the House on that?
We need comprehensive immigration reform. This isn't some wild idea of the Democrats. It's something even President Bush was a cheerleader for when he was president, and he's still doing it, and I appreciate that very much. Our immigration system is broken and needs to be fixed, and we can fix it. We did it over here. We took care of the borders. We made sure that employers and employees aren't in a catch-22 with the employer sanctions legislation. We need to make sure there's a pathway to citizenship for the 11 million people. We have to take care of the 800, 900,000 dreamers. They want to serve in the military. They want to go to school. We're not going to do it on a piecemeal basis, though, and that's what we're hearing from the House. There's going to come a point. You know, it's not often you get the National Chamber of Commerce and AFL-CIO agreeing on a piece of legislation. They agree not a little bit, but a lot. This is important. Why? Because it reduces the debt by $1 trillion, comprehensive immigration
reform. So how confident are you that the House is going to pass comprehensive reform?
I'm kind of a pessimist at heart, Judy, but my optimism is overcoming my pessimism because they have to do it. It's important for the economy, and it's important for the that's why Americans, all Democrats, Republicans, Independents, all agree it's something we need to do.
Just a few brief questions, Senator. One is, it's been reported the president does not have a very good relationship with the Congress. How do you see that?
I've been here 31 years, and every president, that's what they throw at every president. It doesn't matter if it's Reagan, Bush, Carter, it doesn't matter who it is. The president doesn't have good relations with Congress. I mean, the only thing the president hasn't done, he has had the Republicans move into the White House. He takes them to dinner all the time. He has them down to the White House. Now, some of these meetings are not public in nature, but the president has reached out to Republicans a lot. In fact, he's reached out to them so much that some of my Democrats are jealous.
Congressional elections next year. Number of Democratic Senate seats are up. Political experts are out there saying the Senate is ripe for the Republicans to take back control.
I think realistically that's not in the cards. We'd have to lose 6 seats, and that's not going to happen. We have some really good candidates. We have a tremendous candidate who announced yesterday, Sam Nunn's daughter in Georgia. We have the Secretary of State in Kentucky who is now ahead of the Republican leader in Kentucky as we speak. We have all my incumbents are doing just fine. A couple of retirements we're working on, but we're going to be fine. The American people do not like the brand of the Republicans. Let's face it. They've offended Hispanics, African Americans, women, gays. They're going to have to do something to do a little better branding here. And so we have, and that's why all the polls, they really, and I agree with them. I don't like the gridlock here in Congress. I think we should be doing more important things. But all the polls show pox on the Republicans. You know, they are not willing to work with the president. And you know, the Wall Street Journal came out with a poll today, and that clearly says Republicans have a lot of work to do.
Well, picking up on one thing you just said, the president made remarks last week in connection with the Trayvon Martin case about how African Americans are perceived in this country. What did you think about what he said, and what does it say that there's not a single African American Democratic member of the U.S. Senate?
Well, just hold your breath. Cory Booker is on his way from New Jersey, and that'll happen in October. The president made his remarks extemporaneously. Only he could say what he did. And I agree with David Brooks, the Republican columnist from the New York Times. And I'm paraphrasing, but not very much. He said it was one of the most remarkable presentations he's ever seen and thought it was one of the highlights of the president's presidency. So I agree with him. I think this was really remarkable that he had the courage to come out and talk about what's going on in America, and he had some ability to relate to that as an individual.
Finally, 2016, forgive me. In 2008, Senator, you were one of the first prominent figures in Washington to come out for then-Senator Barack Obama for president, choosing him over Hillary Clinton. Of course, we know what happened. Should she run in 2016, and if she did, do you think she would win the election? What do you think her chances
Hillary Clinton may have a bigger fan than Harry Reid. I just don't know who it would be. I think that what she did as a senator, what she did as Secretary of State, will go down in the history books as a remarkable, remarkable job that she did. I, of course, have such admiration for the president. Remember, the last 3 or 4 years he was here, we reduced the debt and created 22 million jobs. Pretty good deal. And I think that they're a pretty good team, but she'll handle things probably even better than he did.
Is that right? Even better?
Oh, yeah.
Would you like to see her run?
I don't know what more I could say to be a cheerleader for her than what I've already said in this interview.
Senator Harry Reid, the majority leader in the Senate, we thank you for talking with us.
You're welcome.